Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Shiloh and the Western Campaign of 1862 by O. Edward Cunningham, edited by Gary D. Joyner and Timothy B. Smith, narrated by Brian P. Craig. Introduction. Civil War books continue to be published at an astounding clip on nearly every topic imaginable. Campaign and battle studies, especially those that eschew social history and take a more traditional military approach, remain very popular with students of the war. Some combats, like the fighting at Gettysburg in the summer of 1863, attract hundreds of writers on every imaginable aspect of the fighting. Others, like the horrific early war battle of Shiloh, catch the attention of far fewer scribes. Given the latter battle's complexity, fascinating cast of characters, and obvious importance to the course of the war, it is difficult to account fully for this lopsided disparity. Some listeners will likely inquire, and with some justification, what makes the publication of a 40-year-old dissertation on the subject of Shiloh worthwhile? And what could possibly be inside a decades-old document that can be touted as new material? There are good reasons behind the decision to publish Dr. Cunningham's Shiloh and the Western Campaign of 1862. For starters, Shiloh is the exception to the mentioned rule. It has been the recipient of only 4 scholarly book-length battle studies. Only 3 of these are academically modern. Wiley Sword's Shiloh, Bloody April, 1974, James Lee McDonough's Shiloh in Hell Before Night, 1977, and Larry J. Daniels' Shiloh, The Battle That Changed the Civil War, 1997. The 4th entry to this rather exclusive group was the first to appear in print more than a century ago. David W. Reed's The Battle of Shiloh and the Organizations Engaged, 1902. There is definitely plenty of elbow room available for another book on the subject. We also firmly believe Dr. Cunningham's work is the best overall account of the Shiloh battle. Reed's study has an early familiarity with the subject seldom seen elsewhere, but it is in no way comprehensive. Sword's book is the best tactical study of the 4. McDonough's account makes for good reading, but offers little tactical detail. Daniel's work breaks ground with his new military history slant. Each of these books has its strengths and weaknesses, just as all books do. We believe Dr. Cunningham's dissertation offers the strengths of each of these works without their associated weaknesses, a feat he managed to accomplish before 3 of these authors ever put pen to paper. Writing in 1989, revered and longtime Shiloh Chief Ranger George Reeves observed that Cunningham's unpublished dissertation is the most detailed analysis of the campaign and the battle. It is also an extremely well-written piece of scholarship, which is not the case with the vast majority of dissertations. His work might be described as a significantly expanded and in-depth version of McDonough's work. Cunningham, however, finished his study more than a decade before McDonough's book appeared. Perhaps most important, Dr. Cunningham's dissertation deserves publication because the passage of 40 years has not, as some might initially believe, dated his efforts. Indeed, listeners will quickly discover it is still a fresh and vivid player in Shiloh historiography. Dr. Cunningham espoused in his 1960s-era dissertation many new ideas about the fighting that were not widely accepted or even seriously considered until very recently. Shiloh and the Western Campaign of 1862 was 40 years, an eternity in Civil War historiography, ahead of its time. It is not, therefore, simply an older treatment of the battle dusted off and repackaged for a wider audience. Shiloh historiography is just now catching up with Cunningham. Historical writing on Shiloh falls into four distinct schools of thought. The first school, post-battle to the late 1880s, is comprised of a recounting of the battle by its participants. The second school of thought, which is the dominant school even today, began with the establishment of the park in 1894. With access to published reports, accounts penned by the veterans, and the battlefield itself, this school insisted that the keys to the battle were the Hornet's Nest and Sunken Road. A more recent third school argued it was Albert Sidney Johnston's death, and not the struggle in the Hornet's Nest, that determined the fate of the battle. The fourth and final school, which is just emerging and quite revisionist in nature, takes a new and almost radical approach to understanding the combat at Shiloh. This school argues that neither the Hornet's Nest nor Johnston's death was the key to the battle. Rather, it was a misunderstanding of the enemy's positions, deployment, and a failure to understand the battlefield's geography that resulted in the Confederate defeat. Simply put, Johnston and others fought the battle incorrectly. The first school of Shiloh historiography, the Veterans School, spanned three decades and consisted of hundreds of works. Large numbers of soldiers, from privates to general officers, wrote about their experiences in the battle. Newspapers ran weekly serials, as did Century Magazine and several others. Old soldiers like Confederate Sam Watkins put their memories on paper for distribution, while more famous personages like U.S. Grant, William T. Sherman, and P.G.T. Beauregard received large sums of money for their recollections. Veterans organizations, such as Army societies, published many reminiscences, as did state historical societies. The flood of information that emerged during these 30-plus years following the war was simply immense. David W. Reed, a Shiloh veteran of the Union Army of the Tennessee and Shiloh National Military Park's first historian, dominated the next period called the Reed School. Appointed in 1895 by Secretary of War Daniel S. Lamont, Reed became the chief historian of the battle. His efforts at marking the field, writing about the battle, and interpreting the events of April 1862 combined to produce a major school of thought that has dominated Shiloh historiography to this day. Reed's findings became manifest on the battlefield, in newspaper accounts, in journal articles, and in two books. The first volume reflecting this was a history of his regiment, the 12th Iowa Infantry. The book emphasized the regiment's activities in the battle, with the Hornet's Nest and Sunken Road playing the major role. With the second book, The Battle of Shiloh and the Organizations Engaged, Reed produced the first volume dealing specifically with the battle itself. Published for the Shiloh Commission by the Government Printing Office in 1902, Reed's study contained a general overview of the campaign, as well as detailed actions of each unit down to the brigade level. He also included orders of battle and casualty tables. Veterans received a free copy, and when the supply was exhausted by 1909, a new edition was produced. The 1909 version incorporated new knowledge and corrected errors in the first edition. When that supply dwindled, the commission reprinted the 1909 edition 4 years later. After the National Park Service took control of the battlefield in 1933, the agency's historians helped institutionalize Reed's thesis. In a 1950s handbook written by park historian Albert Dillahunty, the Hornet's Nest message gained further widespread attention. Sold at Shiloh, these small books gave a short overview of the battle, in which the hornet's nest was emphasized over other sectors of the battlefield. Likewise, the park's 1956 film, Shiloh, Portrait of a Battle, heavily concentrated on the hornet's nest, leaving other actions relatively untouched. This film has been shown to millions of visitors throughout the decades, and was still being shown at the visitor center when this book went to press. It was not until the late 1970s that an academic historian published a book on the battle. A professor at David Lipscomb College in Nashville, James Lee McDonough, produced Shiloh in Hell Before Night, 1977. McDonough's entertainingly written book utilized primary and secondary sources and was well received by the Civil War reading community. Although it is not deep on tactical detail, it is laced with human interest stories and remains useful to the study of the battle. Its appearance played a major role in the perpetuation of the Reed School. Reed developed the idea and the Park Service interpreted it. McDonough's work reinforced and carried the Reed thesis to scholars and public alike. Paralleling the academic emergence of the hornet's nest thesis was a smaller yet equally important school of thought centering on Albert Sidney Johnston's death at Shiloh. One of the few major books on the battle is Wiley Sword's Shiloh, Bloody April, which first appeared in 1974 with a revised 2001 edition. Sword argued that Johnston's death at Shiloh was the key factor in determining ultimate victory and defeat. Although the impact of what has been called the Sword School has not been as significant on popular opinion as the Reed thesis, Sword's Shiloh has played an important role in determining how others interpret the battle. The Johnston death thesis propounded by Sword appeared earlier in the Veterans School, most notably in the writings of Johnston's son, William Preston Johnston. The thesis gained scholarly credence when the first academic biography of Johnston appeared. In 1964, Charles P. Rowland published Albert Sidney Johnston, Soldier of Three Republics. This respected work portrayed Johnston's life in an objective and clearly presented manner. Rowland did not excuse Johnston's mistakes, but he did emphasize that other commanders new to war made similar mistakes. They lived to learn from their sins, a luxury Johnston did not enjoy. Rowland argued that if Johnston had lived, he might have provided the Confederacy with an equal to Robert E. Lee in the Western theater. Sword's major 1974 battle study reinforced the Johnston mystique. An emerging revisionist school of thought incorporates within it the arguments about the hornet's nest and Johnston's fatal wounding, but reaches new conclusions about the meaning and significance of these events. This line of thinking is the first to use the battlefield as a major source. The battlefield holds the key to understanding what happened at Shiloh, not only because of the relatively undisturbed terrain, but also because of the vast array of troop position monuments and tablets erected by the veterans themselves. Thus, in many ways, the field itself provides historians with as much or more insight into the action than simple reports, letters, and diaries. Indeed, most of these revisionist works cite battlefield tablets and monuments in their footnotes. The revisionist school is also the first to challenge former schools in both matter of interpretation and questions of fact. This school explores, for example, the number of charges launched against the hornet's nest, the number of artillery pieces in Confederate Brigadier General Daniel Ruggles's line, and the effects of terrain on the outcome of the battle. Finally, the recent revisionist manner in examining Shiloh is the first to attempt to place the battle in the complete context of Civil War history. Former schools dealt only with the tactical and strategic context of Shiloh. This school also looks at the political as well as the post-war Civil War memory of the nation as a whole. The result is a fresh, if not yet completely coherent, interpretation of the battle. Those well-versed in Shiloh literature will be familiar with the revisionist works of Larry Daniel, Stacy Allen, and Timothy B. Smith. Daniel broke new ground when he published Shiloh, The Battle That Changed the Civil War, 1997. Most important, Daniel incorporated Washington's and Richmond's views of the operations in his coverage of the preliminary strategic campaign leading up to the tactical action. In addition to the political context, Daniel also evaluated the battle from the viewpoint of other eyes, such as those in major cities like New Orleans and Chicago, and even those watching from afar in foreign nations. Daniel's study capably placed the battle in its correct political and social light. Also in 1997, Shiloh's chief ranger, Stacy D. Allen, published a revisionist account of Shiloh in two widely circulated issues of Blue and Gray magazine. These issues also contained fresh interpretations of the battle. Allen was able to document only 7 attacks in 5 hours against the Hornet's Nest position. He noted also that these charges were made in the least populated area of the battlefield. When most of the attacks took place, he explained, the vast majority of the brigades, Confederate and Union, were actively engaged on either the left or the right flank. As far as Allen is concerned, for the majority of the day, the Hornet's Nest was not the critical point on the battlefield. Allen also reached the conclusion that the Confederate command authority, most notably Johnston, misread the Union deployment at Pittsburg Landing in the context of the geography of the site. Timothy B. Smith has written 2 revisionist books that carry on the earlier work of this school. The Great Battlefield of Shiloh, History, Memory, and the Establishment of a Civil War National Military Park, 2004, looked at the establishment of the battlefield park and how that effort shaped how modern historians and readers alike view the Battle of Shiloh. In a memory study, a field that is becoming quite popular, Smith argued that David W. Reed's work in building the park created the dominant school of thought centering on the importance of the Hornet's Nest. Smith's next book, The Untold Story of Shiloh, The Battle and the Battlefield, 2006, was a collection of essays delving into a variety of topics, including myths of Shiloh and the historiography of the battle. Both works continued the emerging revisionist treatment of the battle. The foundations for this nascent revisionist school were poured several decades ago. In 1966, Otis Edward Cunningham graduated from Louisiana State University with a Ph.D. in history. Working under Dr. T. Harry Williams, Cunningham wrote his dissertation, Shiloh and the Western Campaign of 1862, a detailed study that focused largely on the battle itself. Although Cunningham's excellent work predated both McDonough and Sword, his dissertation, laden with original interpretations, was universally ignored by historians in the 1970s. Neither McDonough nor Sword cited Cunningham in their bibliographies. As a result, the revisionist school launched by Cunningham in the 1960s took a 30-year sabbatical. It would not be resuscitated until the 1990s, when historians Daniel, Allen, and Smith began taking a serious interest in this groundbreaking dissertation and incorporating it into their own research. Dr. Cunningham examined the old stories related by Reed and the veterans and invigorated them with a unique freshness not found anywhere else. He located previously untapped sources rich with personal anecdotes and peppered his narrative with them to enliven his work. His study also made positive historiographical advances in the study of Shiloh. Unlike many historians, Cunningham was never content to merely accept the standard version of events. Instead, he carefully studied the sources and analyzed what they revealed. For example, he was the first historian to question the existence of 62 Confederate cannon in Ruggles' artillery-studded line. By carefully examining battery reports and other documentation, Cunningham was able to account for and confirm only 51 artillery pieces in the line. Apparently, Reed had not taken into consideration the losses suffered by some of the Confederate batteries earlier in the day. Another of Dr. Cunningham's contributions was the manner in which he dealt with the hornet's nest thesis, which by this time was deeply ingrained in the American consciousness. He was the first historian to publicly challenge the idea that the sunken road was sunken. He did so by quoting extensively from the participants' own letters and diaries and concluded that the nature of the road was not what gave the Union forces a decided advantage. He believed it was the open fields of fire on the flanks and the impenetrable thicket at the Hornet's Nest that made the sunken road position almost impregnable. Moreover, where the Reed School counted as many as 12 or 13 different charges against the sunken road line, Cunningham documented only 7, and perhaps 8, a calculation with which most modern historians agree. Unlike most historians writing before and after him, Cunningham's study is a much more contextual look at the battle. He emphasized places other than the handful of famous sites like the Hornet's Nest, Peach Orchard, and Bloody Pond. The fighting around the crossroads, where the Hamburg-Purdy and Corinth-Pittsburg roads intersect, offers a prime example. Today's readers of the Civil War are the most informed in history, and yet even most diehard Civil War buffs will draw a blank when asked if they know anything about the fighting at the crossroads on the Shiloh battlefield. Cunningham spent fully as much ink on the western side of the battlefield around the crossroads, an entire chapter, as he did on any other part of the field. He detailed the fighting in that sector and gave it the attention it deserved. The combat waged there is now recognized as more important to the outcome of the battle than previously believed. It should be kept in mind that Cunningham was emphasizing that area of the battlefield 40 years ago. Dr. Cunningham's treatment of the second day at Shiloh, while not as in-depth as his first day's narrative, was in the 1960s the most detailed anyone had written on the April 7th fighting. His unique east-to-west divisional organization methodology is, in our view, easier to understand than other treatments of the fighting. Once the combat wrapped up on the Shiloh battlefield, Cunningham refused to end his study there, as most historians have done. Instead, he followed the army south into Mississippi, treating the siege of Corinth for what it was, a vital part of the Shiloh operation. His decision to do so provides listeners with a much broader and richer context of the Shiloh operation. The footnotes in Cunningham's dissertation explain the uniqueness of his early methodology. He delved deeply into the battle reports, soldiers' letters, newspapers, and post-war reminiscences, but he also walked the field and documented action and troop positions by using the monuments and markers on the battlefield. Few other historians before or since have made such an effort. Even Reed, who placed the monuments and tablets, became mired in the detail and was unable to completely see the larger picture. It should now be clear why Dr. Cunningham's dissertation, important though overlooked in its time, is worthy of publication today. With the new revisionist school less than a decade old and just emerging into the academic world, Cunningham still has much to share with interested listeners. His work is not 40 years dated. Rather, it was four decades ahead of its time, and Shiloh historiography has just begun to catch up with his path-breaking work. Edward Cunningham was one of the bright young scholars of the mid-1960s. He was born Otis Edward Cunningham in Macomb City, Mississippi, on July 20, 1940. He received his elementary and secondary education in the public schools of Pike County, Mississippi, and Tangipahoa Parish, Louisiana. In 1957, he entered Southwest Mississippi Junior College before transferring to Southeastern Louisiana College in Hammond, Louisiana, the following year, where he completed work on his BA degree in 1960. In September of that year, he was admitted to Louisiana State University's Department of History graduate program and received his master's degree in 1962. From 1962 to 1964, he was a graduate assistant at LSU, working toward his PhD in American history. In September 1964, even while he was laboring to complete his dissertation, he joined the faculty of the University of Tennessee at Martin, UTM, in Martin, Tennessee, as an assistant professor of history. Whenever he could spare the time, he made the trip 2 hours south to visit the battlefield at Shiloh. Dr. Cunningham taught at several schools across the nation, including Tulane University, and taught overseas to military men stationed abroad. He published only one book, The Port Hudson Campaign, 1862-1863, LSU 1963. Unfortunately, Dr. Cunningham's career and life came to a premature end with his death on March 2, 1997. Shiloh and the Western Campaign of 1862 is valuable in its original form because it provides a snapshot of what Dr. Cunningham was thinking and how he wrote in 1966. The overriding principle we followed in preparing this study for publication was to let Cunningham's pen tell the story. It is inappropriate to attempt to speak for someone who can no longer speak for himself. Thus, with a very few minor exceptions, what you are about to hear was entirely written by Dr. Cunningham, who is an exceptionally fine researcher and writer, which made our job much easier. Light stylistic alterations were made in the main text to correct slight irregularities and minor issues of grammar and style, changing the designation of Sherman's division to lowercase, for example. Some additional changes were made to the main text, and these require some explanation. The most basic changes came in the form of misspellings, which we simply changed without noting any difference. For example, Dr. Cunningham consistently spelled Lloyd Tilghman as Tilghum. He likewise spelled Charles Whittlesey as Whittlesley and Fraley Field as Farley Field. Dr. Cunningham also made a few errors of fact. For example, he referenced William Bull Nelson as Samuel Nelson, confused Cairo for Paducah as the city at the confluence of the Tennessee and Ohio rivers, and accidentally promoted 6th Iowa Captain Daniel Eisminger to the rank of colonel. On a few occasions, he also misstated some of the regimental numbers. None of these minor errors could be allowed to stand, but we did not believe each occurrence warranted an explanation in a footnote. On some occasions, Dr. Cunningham did not include first names for some of the characters in his human interest stories. This is understandable because finding the names of some of these men in 1966 would have been a monumental research task. Today, however, it is quite easy with the National Park Service's Civil War Soldier and Sailor system on the Internet. With that tool, we found most, but not all, of the missing first names, and simply inserted them into the text. Dr. Cunningham made several statements of interpretation, some of which we agree with and some with which we do not. For instance, we believe Cunningham was on firm ground when he argued that General P.G.T. Beauregard could not have taken Grant's last line on the evening of April 6th, but do not necessarily agree with his claim that Lew Wallace would have been better off had he continued on his original march and suddenly appeared behind enemy lines. Whether we agree with his analysis and interpretation, of course, is not the issue. These are not facts that can be disputed, but issues over which many historians can and do disagree. On matters of this sort, we left his original interpretation. There were, however, some errors we could not allow to pass. For example, Dr. Cunningham asserted that Colonel Everett Peabody's patrol, led by Major James Powell, marched out the Corinth-Pittsburg Landing Road toward Fraley Field. We now know with certainty that Powell led his patrol along what is today called Reconnoitering Road. Dr. Cunningham's claim that Julius Wraith's brigade moved all the way forward to the 53rd Ohio Camp in Ray Field was incorrect, as were his conclusions that James Veitch's first battle position was 200 yards behind John McClernand's line at the crossroads, and that the Confederates penetrated Ralph Buckland's first line at Shiloh Church. In each of these instances, we corrected the text. However, mistakes like these were few and far between. Dr. Cunningham knew his subject extremely well. Only one major alteration was performed on the original dissertation. In his chapter dealing with the Peach Orchard fighting, Dr. Cunningham inserted an unusual paragraph, just two or three sentences long, that completely unraveled the timeline of the action he was describing. Its removal did not delete any material of significance. It is possible the paragraph was a holdover from an earlier draft and overlooked. In discussing Dr. Cunningham's study, the late George Reeves, one of the all-time authorities on the Battle of Shiloh, together with co-author Joseph Allen Frank, wrote, "We believe this dissertation deserves a better fate than remaining a manuscript on microfilm." We obviously agree. We hope our goal of presenting Edward Cunningham's work on Shiloh to the general public will please listeners, spark ongoing vigorous debate, and broaden the knowledge of this great but terrible battle that is so special in the hearts of many people. Gary D. Joyner, Shreveport, Louisiana. Timothy B. Smith, Adamsville, Tennessee. Chapter 1. Along the Rivers. A poet might describe them as arrows running through the heart of the Confederacy. But to the military and political leaders of the North and South back in 1861, the Cumberland, Tennessee, and Mississippi rivers represented something much more prosaic, yet vital. The probable difference between victory and defeat in the American Civil War. Besides serving as a major peacetime avenue of trade for the Western states, these rivers dissected and divided much of the richest area of the South. With its tremendously greater industrial resources, the North could easily utilize these rivers as avenues of invasion into the heartland of the South, striking at the population centers of Tennessee, at the railroad lines connecting the Confederacy, and at the industrial centers that were beginning to bud, notably Chattanooga, Nashville, and Atlanta. The Confederacy, lacking the industrial facilities to build a powerful river fleet, would be forced to utilize river fortifications as a defense against a northern push down the lines of these rivers. One of the prizes in the war in this heartland region was the all-important border states, Kentucky and Missouri. Not only for their geographical locations, but also as a fertile field for recruiting and obtaining munitions, these states were of the utmost importance to both sides. The geographical features of this heartland region, where the war was slowly developing, were significant. The two great rivers, the Tennessee and Cumberland, intersected the region and would be of great use as a means of moving troops and supplies with minimum cost. The Tennessee was navigable from its mouth, through western Kentucky and Tennessee, and into the northern part of Alabama as far as Muscle Shoals, while the Cumberland could be navigated far up beyond Nashville. In the eastern region were the Cumberland Mountains, which could be crossed at certain passes, the most important of which was Cumberland Gap, if the Union forces could develop a strong enough army with a secure logistics base to immediately advance and drive out the comparatively small Confederate force in the area. The Tennessee and Georgia Railway ran up the valley of these mountains into Virginia, making it one of the main lines of communications between the Southern armies operating in that region and the Gulf states. At the city of Chattanooga in East Tennessee, Unionist territory, this railway connected with the Georgia Central Railroad, which led into the heart of Georgia, and with the Memphis and Charleston, which passed into northern Alabama and Mississippi and Memphis, Tennessee. From Louisville, Kentucky, the Louisville and Nashville line ran southward through Bowling Green 100 miles and to Nashville 70 miles farther. From General Albert Sidney Johnston's base at Bowling Green, the Memphis and Ohio passed through Clarksville, Paris, and Humboldt, Tennessee, and to Memphis, 240 miles away. Running from Paris, Tennessee, there was a branch through to Columbus, which was about 170 miles by rail from Bowling Green, the center of the Confederate line. There was a double line of railroads directly from Humboldt into the state of Mississippi. From Nashville, Tennessee, the Nashville-Decatur line ran southward into Alabama, while the Nashville and Chattanooga connected Nashville with the Confederate Railroad Center at Chattanooga. As long as General Johnston could hold the line from Bowling Green to Columbus, he not only plugged off the Cumberland, Tennessee, and Mississippi rivers against a Unionist advance, but he also protected this powerful and important railway system. An advance overland by either army was apt to be an extremely difficult proposition, for the roads in Kentucky and Tennessee were usually of the ordinary country type, which was passable in the summer, but was very difficult to move over when the rains came in winter and spring. Besides the transportation system, there were other pressing reasons why the South had to defend this heartland region. By retaining control of the region, Southern authorities could eventually draw large numbers of conscripts and drafted troops. If the Union Army could occupy this region, then persons of lukewarm sympathy could be drafted into the Federal Army. Also, mines in the extreme southeastern part of Tennessee, at Ducktown, furnished 90% of the copper mined in the Confederacy. Furthermore, Tennessee, with 17 furnaces smelting 2,200 tons of iron ore annually in 1860, was the largest producer of pig iron in the South. The Kentucky-Tennessee region was also tremendously important for the large quantities of foodstuffs produced. In 1860, Kentucky produced almost 7.5 million bushels of wheat, 6 times that of Alabama, while Tennessee produced 5.5 million bushels as compared to less than 600,000 raised in Mississippi. In the same year, Kentucky produced 64 million bushels of corn and Tennessee produced 52 million, as against 29 million for Mississippi and 33 million for Alabama. This meant the Kentucky-Tennessee region not only produced adequate supplies for its own use, but enough to export potentially to other regions of the Confederacy, both for military and civil use. This region was also vastly important for livestock. In 1860, Kentucky was listed in the census records as possessing 355,000 horses, 117,000 mules and asses, and more than a third of a million sheep, while Tennessee followed only slightly behind with 290,000 horses, 126,000 mules and asses, and 750,000 sheep. At this same time, Alabama only had 127,000 horses, 111,000 mules and asses, and 370,000 sheep, while Mississippi followed with 117,000, 110,000, and 352,000, respectively. Thus, not only was this region a breadbasket, but it also would be extremely useful for supplying remounts for Confederate cavalry and work animals for Confederate ordnance and commissary depots. Tennessee also supplied more than a quarter of the scant leather supply that would be available in the Southern Confederacy. Economics as well as strategy dictated that the Confederacy must hold the line in Kentucky and Tennessee. It naturally followed that whoever could gain control would be in a much better position both militarily and politically. The governors of Tennessee and Kentucky both tended to be pro-secessionist, but at the outbreak of war, the legislators tended to either favor a policy of neutrality or were in favor of remaining within the framework of the Union. Using illegal or extra-legal means, pro-Unionist forces quickly gained control of the Missouri state government, seized most of the large stocks of munitions lying within the state, and launched an offensive to clear out pro-Confederate forces from the state. After a preliminary engagement at Booneville, Missouri, Unionist forces led by Brigadier General Nathaniel Lyon began a move southward. Brigadier General Franz Sigel was defeated in a minor action at Carthage, Missouri, but managed to link up with Lyon in time to attack the Confederate Army in Missouri, which was led by Brigadier General Ben McCulloch, and the Missouri State Confederate Guard, commanded by Brigadier General Sterling Pap Price. Lyon was killed in battle at Wilson's Creek, Missouri, on August 10, 1861. And his numerically smaller army was forced to retreat in one of the bloodiest actions for its size in the entire war. The following month, in September, Price succeeded in capturing Lexington, Missouri, after a 2-week siege, but lack of equipment and numbers forced the pro-secessionist forces to withdraw southward. In Kentucky, the situation was even more complex. Brigadier General Simon Bolivar Buckner commanded the Kentucky State Guard, a well-trained and organized military force of about 12,000 men, largely pro-Confederate in sympathy. Buckner, the soul of honor, refused to use his position to advance the cause of the Confederacy and entered into an agreement with Major General George B. McClellan to maintain Kentucky's neutrality. Both sides immediately began raising troops from this state. The Confederates, who were theoretically, at least in the eyes of most Northerners, rebels, unfortunately insisted on acting in the most legal and officious manner possible, while their Northern foe, who supposedly represented the forces of good order and legality, acted with almost true revolutionary zeal. Arms and munitions were brought into Kentucky from northern arsenals, and several bodies of pro-Union Kentucky troops were soon organized, the most important at Camp Dick Robinson in northern Kentucky, commanded by one of the most interesting figures of the war, Brigadier General William Nelson, a naval officer turned soldier in the emergency. The Confederates drew troops from the state, but they set up their camps across the Kentucky line in the friendly state of Tennessee, which had seceded in June. The Kentucky situation finally exploded on September 3, 1861, when Major General Leonidas Polk led Confederate forces across the state line and occupied Columbus, which he immediately began fortifying into one of the strongest Confederate positions in the West. In retaliation for the act, Brigadier General U.S. Grant led a small Union force south, occupying Paducah on the following day. Polk's act was militarily important because it did give the Confederates a good base of operation for their left flank in Kentucky. But it was politically unfortunate because it put on the South the stain of first invading a neutral state and alienated many Kentuckians who might otherwise have been more sympathetic to the Southern position. The line of Confederate forces in Kentucky was soon stabilized, running from Bowling Green in the center, left to Polk's newly acquired position at Columbus, and to the right, roughly to the vicinity of Cumberland Gap. Confederate headquarters were at Bowling Green, on the south bank of the Barren River, where the railroad from Nashville to Louisville crosses. This position also enabled the Southerners to use the Mobile and Ohio Railroad, which crossed over into Tennessee, enabling the Confederates to use rail communications between their center and their left. Across the Mississippi River, the Confederates occupied and began fortifying New Madrid, Missouri, as well as Island No. 10, which actually was an island at a point between the Tennessee and Missouri shores. Even before Tennessee seceded, Union authorities had already begun work on building a fleet capable of potentially dominating this heartland region. At Cairo, Mound City, and St. Louis, Union ironclad warships, as well as wooden gunboats, were quickly constructed and outfitted. Across half a dozen states, Confederate and Union generals raised troops, collected munitions, and tried frantically to put their forces together in some reasonable state of preparation for the fighting that sooner or later would break out. At this early stage in the war, both sides were handicapped by the lack of practical experience, as well as sufficient quantities of supplies and weapons. The South naturally suffered most in this department, lacking funds to buy materials in Europe and resources at home with which to build war equipment. But even the Union forces were often inadequately equipped in the first days of the war. Neither side was prepared to launch any kind of major offensive operation at this time, and most Union leaders were too happy to retain control of Missouri and Kentucky. After the fall of Fort Sumter, Major Robert Anderson, Kentucky-born but loyal to the Union, achieved the status of a national hero, even though he had been forced to yield his position after a two-day bombardment to Brigadier General Pierre-Gustave Toutant Beauregard. Because of his Kentucky connections, Lincoln and other Washington officials thought it would be politically expedient to send him to command in Kentucky once Union and Confederate forces had moved into the state. Anderson was in ill health, and he soon asked to be relieved after little more than a month in service. On October 7th, the hero of Fort Sumter was formally relieved of his command by Brigadier General William Tecumseh Sherman, who, after his services at the Battle of First Manassas, had been appointed to command an infantry brigade at Lexington, Kentucky. Sherman held this command for little more than a week before he became involved in his famous discussion with Secretary of War Simon Cameron over just how many troops would be needed to suppress the rebellion and crush the rebels in the Mississippi and Tennessee valleys. The following month, Sherman was replaced by Brigadier General Don Carlos Buell as head of the Department of the Ohio. Sherman was shunted off for a short rest and was out of the mainstream of events for some weeks while he recovered control of his nerves. With Buell in command in central and eastern Kentucky and the adjacent northern states, and Major General Henry W. Halleck in command of the Department of the West across the river and the District of Western Kentucky, it would seem that the Union Army was suffering from a serious error in divided command. Actually, the division of the West and the various departments was the product of the thinking of the new General-in-Chief of the Union Army, George Brinton McClellan. On November 9th, just 8 days after McClellan assumed his new position as head of the Union Army, he divided the extensive Western Department into the Department of Kansas and Missouri. The latter included not only Missouri, but the western states of Iowa, Wisconsin, Illinois, Arkansas, and the segment of Kentucky lying west of the Cumberland River. Lincoln's home state of Illinois had been in the Western Department since the 3rd of July, but all of Kentucky, with Tennessee, had comprised the old Department of the Cumberland, though forces from the Western Department had been stationed at Paducah and Cairo. With a large but motley collection of half-trained armies scattered on both sides of the Mississippi River, the stage was practically set for the opening of the real war for the Mississippi and Tennessee valleys. But if the stage were set, the casting of the roles of the leading actors was not complete. Most of the characters were on hand, but no one had been picked to direct the play. Major General John Charles Fremont, the famous pathfinder of Western exploration fame, was appointed to command in Missouri and the adjacent territory on July 9th, but his tenure of office was extremely stormy. Politically protected by his wife, a member of the Thomas Hart Benton family, and by tie-ups with Frank Blair, a leading Missourian pro-unionist politician, Fremont enjoyed great renown for his first few weeks in command. But his failure to adequately support General Lyon, and still later his lack of action during the siege of Lexington, caused the administration to lose faith in him, and worse, he succeeded in alienating the influential Blair family by his arrogance and conceit. The Pathfinder was officially relieved of his command on November 2, 1861, and Brigadier General David Hunter, Virginia-born but a strong abolitionist and Union sympathizer, was picked to temporarily succeed him until a new department commander could be brought out from Washington. On November 19th, Major General Henry Wager Halleck arrived at St. Louis to relieve Hunter of his temporary post and to assume the direction of the Department of the Missouri, which also included Kentucky. Hunter was shunted off to a lesser command in Kansas, while Halleck declined to take to the active field against the local Confederate forces, preferring to act as a war director. Brigadier Generals Samuel Curtis and John Pope were given the task of clearing northern and southern Missouri of Confederate irregulars and driving General Sterling Price out of the state. Across the river in eastern Kentucky, the command system was even more confused, if that were possible. By placing both banks of the Mississippi below its junction with the Ohio and the lower part of the Tennessee River under a single central system, McClellan directly paved the way for the operations that would follow during the winter. This led to the elimination of the Department of the Cumberland and the formation of the Department of the Ohio, which would be General Buell's command, consisting of Kentucky, east of the Cumberland River, all of Tennessee, occupied by the Confederate Army, plus Michigan, Indiana, and Ohio. It can be seen from this arrangement that the Tennessee and Cumberland Rivers changed departments as they crossed the Kentucky state line, but at the moment this made little difference, since Tennessee was controlled by Confederate forces. It was a complicated arrangement once offensive operations south began, but for the moment it was adequate. If Generals Buell and Halleck could work together, coordinated by McClellan as General-in-Chief and the good offices of the Secretary of War and the President, then the command system in the West could be made to work without too much friction. South, in Confederate territory, the command system was considerably more simplified. The original Confederate commander, Polk, had been replaced with the arrival of one of the South's greatest wartime heroes, General Albert S. Johnston. The Kentucky-born Confederate leader reached Nashville on September 14th and assumed command of Department No. 2 on the following day. The text of the order giving Johnston his command, issued 5 days earlier, assigned him to direct military operations in Tennessee, Arkansas, that part of Mississippi lying west of the New Orleans, Jackson, and Great Northern and Central Railroad, Kentucky, Missouri, and the Indian Country to the west of Missouri and Arkansas. Johnston was the senior officer in the Confederate Army after the Adjutant General Samuel Cooper, who was too infirm to engage in active field operations. The appointment of a man of Johnston's prestige and repute to command the West demonstrated the force of President Jefferson Davis's feelings in regard to the importance of the theater. But the wisdom of giving such a large command to one man, since everyone assumed that Johnston would also lead the main Confederate field army in battle, is possibly debatable. An old military axiom says that a general should never have to lead one army in person while directing the operations of others at the same time. Whether Johnston could act as soldier and as a master theater strategist would remain to be seen, but at least the Confederate forces in the West would have a certain unity of command that their blue-coated foes would lack, at least for the time being. If General Johnston possessed a national reputation, his foes to the north of the Bowling Green-Columbus line were of a lesser-known quality. None of the leaders who would fight for the Union cause had achieved any spectacular peacetime prominence. Brigadier General U.S. Grant had indeed lived in mediocrity for most of his 39 years. Of distant Scottish ancestry, Grant's family had originally come from Scotland to Massachusetts in May 1630, and later one ancestor fought in the American Revolution. Born on April 27, 1822, Grant, baptized Hiram Ulysses, lived the routine life of a small-town Ohio boy, studying in the local subscription schools of Point Pleasant. Not a terribly capable scholar, Grant worked steadily and doggedly, prodded by his father, who had ambitions for his male child. In the winter of 1838-39, Jesse Grant decided his young son Ulysses needed a higher education, and without consulting him, asked United States Senator Thomas Morris to get the boy an appointment to the Military Academy at West Point, New York. Young Ulysses' reaction when informed by his father that he was going to the academy was a prompt, "But I won't go." He went, however. Grant's stay at the academy was not particularly pleasant, for he always lacked enthusiasm for the routine life of the soldier or cadet. Still, he managed to graduate 21st out of a class of 39. His classmates included William B. Franklin, who won top honors in the class of 1843, Roswell S. Ripley, John J. Peck, J.J. Reynolds, C.C. Augur, Frederick Steele, Rufus Ingalls, and a young New York-born cadet, Franklin Gardner, who would oppose Grant in battle just 19 years later. Assigned to the 4th Infantry, Grant was stationed at Jefferson Barracks near St. Louis, Missouri. Still lacking enthusiasm for a military career, the young second lieutenant began an intensive study in mathematics, the only subject in which he had shown special aptitude at the point, hoping to get an assistant professorship at the academy. One of Lieutenant Grant's former cadet friends, Fred Dent, was a native of St. Louis, and he invited the Ohio boy to his home, where he met the Dent sisters. 6-year-old Emmy was strongly attracted to the nattily uniformed army officer, but it was her 17-year-old sister, Julia, who won Grant's heart. The young couple decided they were in love, but unfortunately the Mexican crisis had taken a turn for the worse, and the War Department ordered the 4th to Fort Jessup, Louisiana. More than 4 years were to pass before the two were finally married on August 22, 1848, after Lieutenant Grant's return from the war. Hostile to the idea of warfare with Mexico and convinced that Southern annexationists were behind all the trouble, Grant loyally obeyed orders, accompanying General Zachary Taylor's army to Louisiana and then to Texas. At Corpus Christi, the army almost lost a new second lieutenant when Grant fell off the transport Suvia into the Gulf of Mexico. Fished out of the water without a scratch, the soggy lieutenant went through a lot of joking and remarks about his clumsiness before his fellow officers let him forget the incident. Surviving the bloody battles of Palo Alto, Resaca de la Palma, and Monterey, Grant was eventually transferred to General Winfield Scott's army, taking part in many of the battles from Veracruz to the capture of Mexico City. Although most of the time a regimental quartermaster, he managed to participate in many of the battles as a combat soldier. In the storming of the Mexican capital, the 4th Infantry was part of William Jenkins Worth's division, and Lieutenant Grant helped drag up the Army's little mountain howitzers, aiding in hoisting them to the roofs of the stone houses from where they could be used to blast out the Mexican defenders. A young naval officer, Rafael Semmes, assisted Grant in moving the guns up. Only a few hundred yards away, P.G.T. Beauregard, Earl Van Dorn, and Adlai Gladden, all of whom would again meet Grant in battle, but under a different flag, fell wounded from Mexican gunfire. Grant's brigade commander reported that the young Ohioan acquitted himself most nobly, and General Worth sent an aide, Lieutenant John C. Pemberton, to bring Grant to divisional headquarters. Just 16 years later, on a hot, sticky day, these two men would meet again, and Grant would receive the surrender of his old war comrade at Vicksburg, Mississippi, following a grim and merciless 47-day siege. With the end of hostilities and with his marriage to Julia, Grant settled down to the routine peacetime army life, serving at Sackett's Harbor and Detroit. Then the 4th was ordered to the Pacific coast, and Julia returned to St. Louis to stay with her family. On the West Coast, Grant lived the dreary life of a bachelor officer. Never particularly enamored with military life, and bored by the deadly dull routine of the isolated outposts at which he was stationed, Grant began drinking. In 1854, possibly to avoid a court-martial, Grant, holding the permanent rank of captain, submitted his resignation to Secretary of War Jefferson Davis. The future Confederate president accepted the resignation, and Grant found himself a civilian once more. Short of funds, the ex-army captain succeeded in getting passage to New York, where he arrived penniless. Staying at a hotel in the city, U.S. Grant attempted to collect an old debt, but without success. His hotel bill began running up, and the hotel manager seized his baggage and ordered him out. At this time, Captain Simon Bolivar Buckner, an old army comrade, happened to run into Grant, and upon discovering the situation, went to the hotel manager and agreed to be responsible for the Ohioan's debt. Grant was allowed to stay in the hotel upon Buckner's promise. Buckner did not loan any money to Grant, as some stories current during the Civil War claimed, and Grant was soon able to settle his own accounts with the aid of his father. The next 6.5 years of Grant's life was a period of mediocrity and failure. As a businessman and farmer, he did not prosper in the little Illinois town of Galena. With the outbreak of hostilities in April 1861, he became involved in local military activities, holding a number of minor military positions in recruiting troops. Weeks passed, and then Governor Dick Yates offered the West Pointer the command of the 21st Illinois Infantry Regiment. This job was no sinecure. The first commander of the regiment was Colonel Simon Good, a handsome, swashbuckling Kentuckian who had served in the Mexican War, the Lopez-Cuba Expedition, and the Kansas Border Wars. Good, although brave, was extremely incompetent, and he had the habit of calling his sentinels from their posts to drink whiskey with him. The troops began getting out of hand, and some of the regiment's officers went to Governor Yates to ask for a new colonel. Someone suggested Captain Grant, and Yates promptly agreed that it should be Grant. Grant arrived at the regiment's camp in civilian clothes, his elbows sticking out through the holes in his worn coat sleeves, and wearing a very battered hat. Used to the more magnificent appearance of Colonel Good, the soldiers made fun of him, and one soldier even pushed him in the back. Later, Grant wrote of the incident, "I found it very hard work for a few days to bring all the men into anything like subordination. But by the application of a little regular army punishment, all were reduced to as good discipline as one could ask." For the next few months, Grant was in eastern Missouri, unsuccessfully chasing parties of Confederate guerrillas. Almost 1,000 miles away, at the home of Senator Lyman Trumbull on 8th Street, Washington, D.C., Illinois congressmen and senators met to vote on placing in nomination for promotion a number of Illinois soldiers. The name of U.S. Grant was first on the list, and when the appointments were presented to President Lincoln and Congress, the nomination of Grant as Brigadier General was approved. Grant first heard of his promotion in a St. Louis newspaper, and he remarked to a chaplain standing nearby, "I had no suspicion of it. It never came from any request of mine. It must be some of Washburn's work." In September, Brigadier General Grant led an invasion of Kentucky, occupying Paducah on the 4th. For the next 2 months, he was busy raising and organizing an army around Paducah and in threatening the Confederate base at Columbus, Kentucky. On November 7th, Grant drew blood for the first time in a strike at the small Confederate garrison at Belmont, Missouri. Ferried over by the Navy, Grant routed the small Confederate army, but Southern reinforcements arrived and the newly appointed brigadier was forced to abandon the Confederate camp, load his army on the Navy transports, and with naval gunfire covering him, retire to Paducah. Union and Confederate armies both claimed the victory at Belmont. Union losses were 607 men against 641 Confederate casualties. The first real battle in the West since Wilson's Creek, the engagement attracted great publicity and made U.S. Grant the rising star of the Union Army in that theater. It was not so much that Belmont was a great victory for the North, but rather that Grant had bothered to fight at all, while dozens of other Union generals sat around training troops, bragging to newspapers, or causing trouble for the administration in Washington. The man who would become one of Grant's closest friends and most loyal supporter came from a background in many ways similar to Grant's. William Tecumseh Sherman, although of Ohio birth, was 2 years older than the man who had become his trusted superior, and who with him would make up one of the deadliest fighting teams in military history. The death of his father when the boy was 9 caused young Tecumseh to be brought up by United States Senator Thomas Ewing, a friend and fellow citizen of his father. The Ewing family was influential in Middle Western politics, which gave Sherman something of an edge over Grant in seeking public advancement. As a lad, Sherman received a sound education in the local academy at Lancaster, but in 1836, Ewing secured an appointment for him at West Point. Always something of a rebel, the young Ohioan did not particularly excel at the academy, disdaining the strict conformity to rules which was expected of the cadets. Even so, at the isolated post among the highlands of the Hudson River Valley, young Sherman survived the grueling grind to eventually graduate in the same year that a young plebe from Ohio, U.S. Grant, entered. Sherman's grades were fairly good, although his records show a respectable collection of demerits, and after graduation he was commissioned with the 5th Infantry Regiment. After service in various military posts, Sherman eventually was sent to California, where he left the army to go into business. Still later, he migrated to Louisiana, where he became superintendent of what later became Louisiana State University at Alexandria from 1860 to 1861. At the age of 41, Sherman re-entered the United States Army. The first 41 years of his life had been a record of frustrated ambitions and minor successes. At the Battle of First Manassas, he led a brigade with considerable success, but it was only with his transfer from the Army of the Potomac to the Western Theater that Sherman began to exhibit any unusual or outstanding characteristics. Unfortunately, those characteristics he first demonstrated were those of emotional instability and possibly even derangement. Sherman always had a sense of the dramatic and tended to see things in an extremely pessimistic light on some occasions. The responsibilities of a major command tended to overly upset him and led to his eventual removal from command in Kentucky. After a short spell of duty in Missouri, where he helped create a panic by insisting that Confederate forces under General Price were advancing on him, he was eventually shifted away to avoid embarrassment. A few weeks of rest, and the redoubtable Tecumseh was ready for a field command again. This time, it would be an infantry division under his fellow Ohioan, General U.S. Grant. Somehow, these two men hit it off. Possibly it was because neither of them had ever achieved any particular success, and this helped create some sort of bond between them. Not so much a recognition of mediocrity, but rather a sense of feeling they could achieve something if only given the opportunity. Or perhaps it was simply that the men liked each other. Anyway, they would work together as Corps Commander and Army Commander to help create the military victory that would preserve the American Union. The third member of the military group that would dominate military affairs in the West at this time was Don Carlos Buell, Major General of United States Volunteers. Born on March 23, 1818, and of Welsh descent, Buell, like Sherman and Grant, was an Ohioan. His father died when he was very young, and he was reared by an uncle, George P. Buell of Lawrenceburg, Indiana. After the usual education for a member of the rough and semi-frontier society, young Buell entered West Point, and upon graduating was assigned to service with the 3rd Infantry Regiment. After service in the Seminole War, he joined Taylor in Texas, and was breveted captain for meritorious service at the Battle of Monterey on September 23, 1846. Much later, in the double battle of Contreras and Churubusco, Don Carlos Buell was breveted again for gallant conduct. His peacetime service was honorable but not particularly distinguished, and in April 1861, Buell was a lieutenant colonel in the adjutant general's office. Promoted to major general, he helped organize and train troops for the Army of the Potomac, where his services were apparently extremely creditable. Buell and McClellan, his superior at the time, seemed to work well together, and apparently there was a close, friendly relationship between the two men, something like that existing between Fritz John Porter and the young general-in-chief. In November, Buell arrived in Kentucky to take command of the Army of the Ohio, sometimes known as the Army of the Cumberland. Basically, his job was to secure the Union left flank in the west and eventually invade eastern Tennessee. A lack of combat experience and practical experience in handling troops in the field was not particularly a handicap, as there was virtually no one in either army, Union or Confederate, with such a background. Buell seems to have been thought of favorably by most of his contemporaries at this time. Of medium stature, Buell wore a full beard and possessed an extremely stern appearance. The only person who seems to have registered any criticism of Buell at this time was a young officer serving under Grant, who wrote in a letter that Buell is too cautious. Only time would tell whether Buell would have the necessary aggressiveness and skill to command a field army. Fourth of the major Union Army officers, but certainly not least, was Henry Wager Halleck. One of the most controversial figures of the war, Halleck at one time or another was condemned by just about every major figure in the entire Union Army. William T. Sherman was one of the very few who seemed to always favor Halleck and respect him for his undoubted administrative ability. Halleck's tragedy was that he was called on to perform the functions of a daring, dashing field commander, while basically at heart, he was simply a bookkeeping bureaucratic official. If Halleck was a little lacking in the abilities necessary for an aggressive field commander, he was fortunate in that his subordinates had these qualities. One of his most able men was Brigadier General Charles Ferguson Smith, a man whose untimely death cut short possibly a brilliant career, perhaps even the supreme command of Union armed forces. Smith, a native of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, entered West Point in 1820 at the age of 13, graduating 5 years later. After holding various field positions, he returned to West Point in 1829 as an instructor, which post he held for 13 years under Sylvanus Thayer, then head of the school. It was the Mexican War that gave Smith his great opportunity, and he took full advantage of it. Captain Smith led the advance of General Zachary Taylor's army across the Salt Lagoon at Arroyo, Colorado, in March 1846. Just days later, he scouted the position of the Mexican army at Resaca de Guerrero. As a measure of trust in him, General Taylor assigned Smith the duty of taking a force of artillery and Texas cavalry and assaulting the Mexican army's position on the redoubt at the western end of the summit of Federation Hill.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.